much for the introduction. The pleasure for me is to be again in Rio de Janeiro. I will talk about, I am also the director of the new Max Planck Laboratory in Structural Biology, Chemistry and Molecular Biophysics of Rosario in Argentina. That is partnered with the molecular, with the Max Planck the Biophysical Chemistry in Argentina. First of all, I would like to show, to some of you, where is Rosario in Argentina. And this is a particular city, because in this city, the Che Guevara was born. And also, the first soccer player that I have never seen in my life was born there, Messi. and also, it's a city in which some crazy scientists meet with politicians, trying to convince them to make investment in science in Argentina, and to be honest, we have succeeded in that. So I will talk now about sinucrine, and you can see that the evidences that link the amyloid aggregation of this protein with the onset of Parkinson's disease are quite recent. I mean, what it means that it's a very active field of research. If you compare with, for example, Alzheimer's or Prion disease, there is a lot of work to be done still in this field. The protein itself is a small protein, 140 amino acid protein, and that is produced in dopamine neurons, and the residues are well distributed in three well-defined regions of the protein: the N-terminal region, that is amphipathic, with several lysine residues there; the NAC region, that is highly hydrophobic, and it's related to the amyloidogenicity of the protein; and the C-terminus, that is very rich in negative charged amino acids, as glutamic and aspartic, and also several proline residues, and is negatively charged of this region. Unfortunately, or fortunately, I don't know, the monomeric state of this protein belongs to the family of intrinsically disordered proteins, which means proteins that lack global folding and that lack rich element of secondary structure. The physiological role is under discussion, and the conformation of the native state of the protein is also under discussion. As we already heard in the lecture by Hilary Lashwell, so the amyloid aggregation of alpha synuclein, as happens with other proteins linking to neurodegeneration, is a self-associated process in which the proteins start to form small aggregates that then give rise to the depositions as amyloid fibrils. In this case, this deposition occurs in the substantia nigra pars compacta and affects mainly dopaminergic neurons, giving rise to the Parkinson's disease. Fortunately, we can monitor this event in vitro and obtain fibrils with the same morphology that the one found in patients with Parkinson's disease. And we can monitor, for example, by using a fluorescent approach in which monitor the transition of the different species from the monomeric species to intermediate of different complexity. This is a nucleation-dependent process. While the nucleus is formed, the process is triggered dramatically. Following to the lag phase or the nucleation phase, there is a growing phase, and finally, of course, the deposition of amyloid fibrils. This process is accelerated or inhibited by different factors and effectors. I always like to study the interaction of protein-protein interaction of ligands with proteins, and to understand which are the structural modification that are derived from this interaction how this can change or modify the biological activity of the protein. Sorry. Dependent phenomenon,
right,
that has a lack of nutrition phase, right, and exponential growing of the fibers.
I believe, I could be wrong about this, but in every one I've looked at, it's only the prions where you see the exponential growth. If you look at the other amyloid diseases, there is nucleated growth, but it follows a slower growth than in the prions.
No, indeed, we can mathematically explain the different phases of that, and that there is a factor considering the exponential growth of the fiber. This is also happens to my knowledge, it's not just a phenomenon that is only restricted to prion disease.
I believe it is, but
the kinetics
exactly. All the equations that governing this process are carefully described there, and indeed the exponential growth forms part of this. It's a term that forms part of this equation. I can send you the
which is the author.
We are the authors. There are different factors and effectors that modify the amyloidogenicity of the proteins, and what we investigate in our lab is how these effectors modify the structural properties and dynamic properties of the protein, and how this can be interpreted in terms of the changes in the amyloidogenicity of the protein. So, what we mainly focus is in the early change that takes place in the monomeric state upon ligand interaction that give rise to a population and an intermediate state that is more prone to aggregate. And after this species is populated, then the amyloidogenic process is triggered. So I will talk today about the role of metal ions in neurodegeneration. This is a well-proved field and well-studied and characterized field in Alzheimer's disease, in prion disease, and this is a field that we developed since 05 to now in the case of Parkinson's disease. And we'll also talk about the use of amyloid inhibitors to try to slow down the amyloidogenicity, the kinetic of aggregation of alpha-synuclein. But mainly focuses in the structural basis of the interaction and how from this structural basis we can understand the molecular mechanism behind this structural basis. So, as I mentioned, if you compare the alpha-synuclein with the other proteins involved in neurodegeneration, for example, IPP, this is a precursor of a beta peptide in Alzheimer's disease, or prion protein, which has a well-folded domain followed by a disordered domain. This protein corresponds to the family of intrinsically disordered proteins. It means that we have a highly dynamic disordered state that exchange between multiple conformations. And the protein cannot be crystallized. And if you want to give an idea of which are the changes that are induced by this ligand, this biological relevant ligands that accelerate or inhibit aggregation of the protein, then you need a starting point. And the starting point is which are the structural and dynamic features of the proteins in the free state. So during my stay in the Max Planck Laboratory in the Department of NMR Basic Structural Biology from Christian Griesinger, I learned to use a strategy that was developed by the group of Christian Marcus Schwestetter was based in the use and application of paramagnetic spin levels that I will explain later, because in this case we cannot get a strategy that is a standard strategy that is used in NMR to get the idea about this, the global form of the protein, that is to get distant information through NOE measurements to determine the global form of the protein, or to obtain the dihedral angle information through shape coupling constants. We cannot use this approach here. So we developed under the supervision of Marcus Stetter in 04 or 05 there in the Max Planck Institute, a strategy that I will explain later. This is, for example, if you compare how looks in spectra, a 2D spectra, and this is an HSQC spectra, in which each cross peaks or each signal here correspond to an amide group in the protein. This is only what I need you know, okay? That each cross peak here correspond to an amide group in the protein. So we expect at least to detect as a maximum as many cross peaks as amino acids we have in the protein. This doesn't happen because some of these residues are exposed to the solvent, so we lose this signal coming from the amide group because they are broadened beyond detection, and also because proline has no amide groups. So, but the bottleneck in this process is firstly to assign this cross peak to a specific amino acid in the sequence of the protein. And after that, I mean, to say this cross peak corresponds to alanine in position 124 and this corresponds to methionine in position 5. Because after that, we can obtain, by using different approaches, the structural and dynamic information and relate this information to a specific location in the protein architecture. So this is very difficult, as you can see in the case of to make the assignments. Also, it's a very difficult task compared with the well-folded protein, because folding means dispersion of chemical shift. Folding means higher resolution. Here you have a very poor dispersion. That means we have all the signal concentrated in a very small range of chemical shift, which of course is very difficult to work. That and we have to use a specific approach based mainly in heteronuclear, I mean nitrogen 15 and carbon 13. Second, this is the parameters, for example, that you use, the change in chemical shift of alpha carbon. This is how they look in a globular protein to characterize the secondary structure elements along the protein structure. In the case of intrinsically disordered proteins, I mean, each parameter that we measure is an average, it's a population-weighted average over all the structures that are sampled by the protein in the different conformations. So here we cannot talk about the structure in terms of rigidity. We talk about a tendency, a propensity to adopt certain structures. So you see that the changes in the parameters are also very small because they are population-weighted average over all the structure sampled by alpha-synuclein in ensemble conformation. So it's also very difficult to obtain the structural and dynamics information about the protein. So it's just to give you an overview of the different. So the alternative, since we cannot use an NOE-based approach to get the global or to determine the global flow of the protein, we use an excellent alternative that is the use of paramagnetic spin labels. What are paramagnetic spin labels? Are small molecules that has an electron and pair in their structure. So when these paramagnetic spin labels are attached to the side chain of covalently, I mean, to the side chain of a specific amino acid, this gives rise to a dramatic enhancement in the relaxation rates of the nucleus from the amino acids that are in the vicinity of this paramagnetic space layer. In this case, vicinity means between 20 and 25 angstroms. So a distance that cannot be, a long ray distance that cannot be measured by any anode. So this is an excellent alternative to get idea or to determine long range interaction in the protein and to try to elucidate the global fold of the protein. So let's see how it works. So the first point, okay, is to produce the recombinant protein isotopically labeled in nitrogen 15 and carbon 17, because it's, this is in this case is critical because it is an intrinsically disordered protein. So we have to use it mainly an approach based in heteronuclei. We try to use as very high magnetic field. It means don't forget that if you have to increase the concentration of the protein to gain more sensitivity, then this is an amyloidogenic protein, so the protein may start to aggregate. So the idea is to decrease the concentration of the protein as possible, and to use, for example, all the possibilities that we have to increase the sensitivity. Okay, higher magnetic field that increase the sensitivity of the experiment, or cryopro devices that also increase substantially the sensitivity of the experiment. And of course, record the 2D maps that we mainly will work here with HSQC experiment, that in this experiment we detect signals that correspond to a correlation through bond correlation, through chemical bond correlation between an amide proton and an amide nitrogen. So each cross peak, I repeat, corresponds to each amide group, each amino acid in the molecule. The first stage is then, or the first step is to assign unequivocally these signals to a specific amino acid in the sequence. And after that, we can obtain a structural dynamic information from these signals, and then we know that which will be the dynamic property of different parts of different locations in the protein. How works our approach? In the case of alpha-synuclein, we decided to attach the paramagnetic spin label to three different parts of the protein. I mean, this spin label that we use, MTSL, this is the small molecule that has an unpaired electron. And it's, of course, I mean, we lack cysteines in alpha-synuclein. So we had to do the previous molecular biology work to make mutation on different parts of the protein to introduce, to attach this paramagnetic spin label. So once you attach this paramagnetic spin label to the protein, those signals that are beyond 25 angstrom, this is the signal of an amino acid, and this is the signal in red of the same amino acid, once that the paramagnetic spin label has been attached to the probe. So if the signal is not broadened, it means the intensity of the signal is not modified, it means that the residue is located to a longer distance than 25 angstrom. But if the signal is affected, it means that this amino acid is located within the distance of 25 amino acid with respect to the place in which a paramagnetic spin label has been attached. And the degree of broadening depends of the distance. So if we measure the intensity of the degree of broadening, then we can get an idea, we can translate this information into distance restraints and to build a family of a structure characterizing the native or the monomeric state of the protein. The main advantage that we are exploiting here is that this is a dipolar interaction that depends on the distance. Larger the distance, is weaker is the dipolar interaction. This is a dipolar interaction that, as Christian told you today, for example, in the case of residual dipolar coupling, occurs between nuclear spins. In this case, the interaction not depends on, don't take place between nuclear spins, but between a nuclear spin and an electron spin. And the point is that the magnetogenic radio or magnetogenic constant that give rise to these effects of the electron is hundreds of times higher than that of the nucleus. Then the enhancement on the relaxation by this interaction is dramatically larger than this produced by the interaction between nuclear spins. And so this is the fact that we exploit to get long-range information to determine the global fold of the protein. Then let's go, this is just an schematic to show you. We have a peptide that is isotopical label in nitrogen 15. We expect to detect 5 signals. If we are talking about an HLQC experiment in which we detect amide groups. If the paramagnetic spin level is attached to the first residue, and this is the protein or the peptide of an extended conformation, then this signal will broaden beyond detection. This will be broadened in a lesser percentage, and we are only just to detect 3 signals. But if the protein is folded, this is the map that we will obtain. Almost all these signals set residue 3, at position 3, will be broadened. And this is an extreme situation in which I am just schematically showing that this signal disappears, but these signals are broadened, and the degree of broadening depends on the distance between these signals and the location of the paramagnetic spin layer. So let's go to real life. This is an HLQC spectra of the protein without the paramagnetic spin label, and this is the protein with the paramagnetic spin label attached to amino acid at position 19. And you can see that there is some signal that disappear from the spectra, are broadening beyond detection, and there are some signals that are not affected. It means these signals are within this 20 to 25 angstrom distance, and these signals are beyond this limit. So if you measure the intensity of the signals in this spectra and compare with the intensity of this signal in this spectra, then you can get, and you plot this intensity information in terms of the residue number, in terms of the protein sequence, then you can get a profile that is giving you information about what's going on. And this is the profile, for example. This is the profile that you can measure. When the paramagnetic spin level was attached at position 18, this is the profile that we were supposed to obtain if the protein was in a complete disorder and extended unfolded conformation. As you can see, this was not the case. We get this profile in which all the residues that are close to the paramagnetic probe or to the paramagnetic spin label are broadened beyond detection, but also there are a degree of broadening here. What is showing that there is a long-range interaction between the C-terminal region of the protein and the N-terminal region of the protein in which the paramagnetic spin label has been attached. There is a transient long-range interaction between these two regions. And also, when the paramagnetic spin level is attached to the hydrophobic region at position 90, you can see that there is the intensity of the signal here that are substantially decreased. I mean, they are closed in the space. And of course, this is showing that an interaction takes place between the hydrophobic central region and the C-terminal central region. So, well, this is our starting point. And our starting point is demonstrating that in the native or in the monomeric state of the protein assumes aggregation of the inhibitory conformation that are stabilized by low-rank interaction and then protects alpha-synuclein from the amyloid aggregation. If these interactions are destabilized, then the intermediate species that are more prone to aggregate, they start to be populated, and the amyloid aggregation is triggered. So the idea is try to not destabilize this long interaction that gives rise to aggregation, autoinhibitory conformation in the protein. So this is our starting point. Let's see now how we can link a structural biology with molecular and cell biology, because mainly we spend a lot of time in the lab, so we try to have fun. I mean, always there are biological problems that has to be solved. It makes no sense to make a structure if then you don't translate this information into a biological mechanism or biological activity. We also use a strategy that was based in residual deep recaplings. As Christian explained to you today, if the protein, due to the dipolar interactions between nuclear spins, the nuclei are allowed it to relax. But this behavior, this dipolar interaction, are not observed in the NMR spectra because it averages to zero due to the isotropic time of the molecule in solution. But, however, if the proteins or the rotational motion of the protein may be restricted toward a preferred direction, I will say the protein is isotropical, anisotropically aligned, a split can be measured from the unique signal that we detect in solution. And this, the separation, the magnitude of this splitting is what we call the residual dipolar coupling. And since it depends not only of the distance between the nucleus, but on the orientation of the molecule, which regard with respect to the static magnetic field, there is a lot of structural and dynamic information in this parameter. In principle, this relaxation parameter that you compare residual deeper coupling with R1, R2, or NOE that Christian was talking to today, they are sensitive to motion in different time scales. So as you can see, by measuring this parameter, you can detect motion in the pico to nano second scale, and also by measuring R2 detect motion in between the microseconds to milliseconds. But instead, if you measure residual dipolar coupling, you are able to detect motion in all these time scale. Here you have a gap that you are losing. So, for example, in the case of alpha-synuclein, if you measure L1, R2, and NOE, you don't see any difference along the sequence of the protein, because the flexibility and the protein is highly dynamic. There is no restriction of motion in the pico to nano scale. But, however, if you use different alignment media and you align anisotropically the molecule and you are able to split the unique signal from solution to this alignment media and to measure this distance, you will be able to obtain a profile, and a residual dipolar coupling profile. We are measuring the residual dipolar coupling here between the amine nitrogen and the proton amide that is directly or covalently bound to this amine nitrogen. And of course, we expected in this case to obtain a profile that would be characterized by very low values of residual dipolar couplings. But it was surprising to us that we get a concentration or large values of residual dipolar coupling in the C-terminal region of the protein. And what does it mean? It means that there is restriction of motion there, and there is a residual structure that is located in that region. Of course, you can even compare what happened when you make or perform the studies in the presence of urea. Urea is able to destabilize hydrophobic interactions. So you can see this is the paramagnetic spin labeling profile that we have measured for the free protein when the spin level was at position 90. And in the presence of urea, you can see that in this case, the signals in the C-terminus region are increasing. What is demonstrating that this long interaction between the NAC region and the C-terminus region are weakened now, are destabilized. And of course, they should be of hydrophobic nature. This is also monitored by the residual dipolar couplings. You see how the residual dipolar couplings in this region is decreased almost to the level of the rest of the protein in the presence of increasing amounts of urea. So both processes are detecting, both parameters are detecting the presence of a long-range interaction that are transient in the protein. And this is very important because these are the parameters that we will use along our studies. So when we started to study the metallobiology of Parkinson's disease, if you compare the studies that had been performed at this stage was in between 05 or 06, and of course we are one of the leader groups in the field in the metallobiology of Parkinson's disease, and we are still working on that. There were more than 100 publications in this case, or in the case of Alzheimer's or Bryant disease, but only just 10 publications. And here, in the case of alpha-synuclein or Parkinson's disease, and indeed there were several studies describing the interaction between the copper and other metal ions with A beta peptide and prion protein, because indeed this balance or the misregulation, the homeostasis of metal ion is strongly linked with prion, and indeed one of the strategies that is being used for patients with Alzheimer's disease is the use of metal chelators to try to avoid the acceleration that this metal ion induces on the amyloid assembly of these target proteins. But it's very important to design the experiment correctly if you want to get the information, the right information. At this stage, there was just two biophysical structural works that were published. And what the conclusion from this work was that the effects induced by the metal ions was mainly due to the interaction with the C-terminal region. Don't forget that the C-terminal region is very rich in amino acid with negative charge. What it was proposed, an electrostatic interaction that was mediating this effect, and that copper, aluminum, iron, and manganese were the most effective metal ions in accelerating the aggregation of the protein. And of course, these are biological relevant metal ions. But please take a look at the condition in which the experiments were performed. 35 micromolar protein concentration, 2 millimolars metal ions. This concentration of metal ions is far away from you can find in any normal or pathological tissue, I'm sure. So the biological implication of this work, I mean, regarding to the interaction of coppers, they detected that another study informed there were 10 binding sites for copper in alpha-synuclein, and with a KD in the micromolar range. But they use a very weak technique here. This is the only information that we got at this stage. So the first experiment that we started to perform is try to work in more physiologically relevant condition. I mean, decreasing substantially the amount of the concentration or the levels of metal ions used in the studies. So we found by monitoring the aggregation kinetics of alpha-synuclein by fluorescence that copper levels in the low micromolar range were able to accelerate the aggregation of the protein. We didn't need to add or to make the protein to interact with millimolar levels of copper. Of course, this is more physiologically relevant. Copper was included, was incorporated in the amyloid fibers formed by the protein. When we compare the effect of copper, of the low micromolar levels of copper, with those of other metal ions, as manganese and iron, what we observe is that under our condition, I mean using low micromolar concentration of metal ions, the only metal ion that was affected in inducing the aggregation of the protein or in accelerating the aggregation of the protein was copper in the oxidative state. Iron and manganese were not affected in inducing the aggregation of the protein under this condition. But previously it was demonstrated that when you use millimolar concentration, all these metal ions were very effective. So here we have a differential behavior about the metal ions. So what is the, it is related to the affinity, the different affinity of the metal ion by the protein. What is the structural explanation behind this behavior? I mean, and what we measure by using electronic absorption spectroscopy and monitoring the changes in the DD transition band of the copper complex, how this band evolves upon increasing the concentration of copper, then we can make a fitting of the core that we have built to a model. And what we obtain from here is that alpha-synuclein were able to bind three copper ions. Two of these copper ions were in the low micromolar to micromolar range, and the third metal ion, the third equivalent of this metal ion, were able to interact also with the protein, but with very low affinity in the millimolar range. So we are already correcting the literature that is publishing also. And this is because the experiment was well designed. What is the structural explanation for that? Why the copper is able to induce, I mean, if we think in affinity, let's think a little bit. We have demonstrated that, copper is able to bind to the protein with an affinity or a dissociation constant in the low micromolar range. So it means that when we add micromolar concentration of copper, a considerable amount of complex is formed between the protein and the copper ion. And this is this complex, the entity that they give rise to the enhancement of the amyloidogenicity. In the case of the other metal ions, probably the interaction just takes place in the millimolar range. So when you add micromolar range of manganese or iron, the amount of complex that is formed is really very, very, very small. So it's not enough to induce or to accelerate the aggregation of the protein. This is the explanation why the affinity explanation, why copper is effective and in the low micromolar concentration and the other metal ions are not. So indeed we measure the affinity of the other metal ions and by synuclein and is in the millimolar. Which is a structural explanation. I mean, it was proposed and published that this metal ion in the millimolar range were able to accelerate the aggregation of the protein by a mechanism that was mediated by the interaction of the metal ion with the C-terminus region through a electrostatic interaction. Fortunately, these metal ions are also paramagnetic. It means when they bound to some residue, it gives rise to an enhancement of the relaxation of these residues in the vicinity of the binding site. So this the signal from this amino acid also disappears from the spectrum. Okay? the radio or the area in which the relaxation enhancement is operative is smaller if you compare with the paramagnetic spin level MT scale that we have used. In the case of copper, it's operative until 10 to 11 angstrom. In the case of MTSL, it was operative until 25 angstrom. So you can see what happened. If you add copper, for example, in one spectrum, you measure the broadening induced over some signal, you compare with the intensity of this signal in the absence of copper, then you can build these profiles. And what is this profile showing you? This is a profile corresponding to copper. You can see here is an overlay of spectra. There are the spectra in red correspond to the free proton. The spectra in blue correspond to the spectra in the presence of this metal ion. So these signals that disappear from the spectra are or correspond to amino acids that are involved in metal binding. Because if they are affected, it means that they are able to bind copper or manganese or iron. This is the profile in the case of copper. You mean there are two binding sites that are located in the N-terminal region and a third binding site that is located in the C-terminal region. So what was proposed was also not correct. Copper binds mainly to the N-terminal region of the protein. In the case of the other metal ions, they bind exclusively to the C-terminal region of the protein, and mainly due to probably long electrostatic interaction. So we have a different biological effect, different affinity, and a structural determinants that are also different and that allow us to explain why one metal ion is affected and the other metal ion are not affected. Our under experimental condition. So, this is the profile that we get with copper, a very low copper concentration. This is two regions in the protein are affected. These two regions are located in the end terminals of the protein. And only when you increase the concentration of copper, the C-terminal region is affected. It means this is the lower affinity site because you need to increase the concentration to match. So this is the millimolar range affinity binding site. And these two sites should correspond to the affinity between 0.1 and 35 micromolar. This is what happened in the case of manganese, for example. Also, it's a paramagnetic metal ion. So you see that if you increase the concentration of the paramagnetic metal ion, you see that almost all the C-terminal region is affected. But then if you start to decrease the concentration of the metal ion, you are able to identify the primary binding site for these metal ions in the C-terminal region. And that involves these residues. And if you compare this behavior with the residual dipolar coupling, you can see here that the main effective region, the primary effective region by the binding of the metal ion relates with the residual structure at the C-terminal region. That means the interaction is driven mainly by the residual dipolar structure at the C-terminal region and not by electrostatic nature of the interaction. So we have now this information. Copper is able to bind mainly and with high affinity to the N-terminal region of the protein. We have identified two binding regions in the N-terminal protein, and as a region in the C-terminus that is in the millimolar range, but we still don't know which is the high affinity binding site in the N-terminus because two regions has been affected. And we have two affinity constants here. One, the dissociation constant is 0.1 micromolar, and the other one that is 35 micromolar. So the challenge now is to identify which is the higher, where is located the higher affinity binding site, within this region or within this region. Because the effect induced by copper is mainly detected by the binding to the high affinity binding site. Then, if we identify which is the high affinity binding site, we can start to elucidate or to think about the molecular mechanism behind the effect of copper. So this is the mainly the picture that resume that this the copper is able to induce the aggregation of the protein in a micromolar range, and because it binds to the N-terminal region, it binds specifically where the other metal ions are not effective in this concentration because they bind with very low affinity and exclusively and specifically to the C-terminal region of the protein. So which are the metal and chlorine residues for copper binding, and where are they located? So to do that, in our group we use a battery of biophysical techniques. We just don't focus now not only in NMR, but we use CT spectroscopy, electron absorption spectroscopy, mass spectrometry. And in this case we use an approach that is very well used to identify histidine residues in global protein that are more exposed to the solvent. And so we adapted this strategy to our model. This is a compound, diethyl pyrocarbonate, that binds mainly to imidazole rings of histidine, but depending on the condition, is also able to interact with tyrosine and mainly with amino terminal groups or amino groups in the side chain for lysine, for example. So what is the idea of this strategy? So if we incubate the protein with DPC, this location in the proteins that are modified by DPC will experiment and increase in the molecular weight. And so we will be able to detect by mass spectrometry. If we pre-incubate the protein with copper, those sites in which, or those locations which copper is bound, will be protected against the effect of diethyl pyrocarbonate. So this metal binding site shouldn't be affected, wouldn't be affected by the presence of copper, by the presence of the DPC. So this is the profile that we got. This is for the free proteins. This is the protein incubated by DPC. You can see that it's six sites in which the protein has been modified by the ethyl pyrocarbonates. And this is upon the same spectra recorded in those samples that were pre-incubated by copper. You see that the interaction with copper protects two sites in the molecule from the modification by DPC. Only four modification sites are identified in the molecule. When we work with histidine mutant, since we know that copper has a high affinity for imidazole rings, we made this mutation. So indeed, DPC that also modified imidazole rings was able to modify just five sites in the molecule. And in this case, only one site in the molecule was protected by copper interaction or by copper in pre-incubation. It means that histidine 50 is one of the current residues for copper binding. If you perform the same experiment but just linking this with tryptic digestion, then you can analyze the different fragments in the protein, and by using that I will not go into details. We found that the N-terminal amino group of methionine in position 1 was the other acolyne residue for copper binding, which of course relates strongly with the regions that we are detected by NMR. This region contains the histidine and this region contains the methionine. And you can see also from NMR that when we modify studied the interaction of copper with histidine by NMR in the histidine mutant, the other two regions, two binding sites are not affected. What is demonstrating that these binding sites are not interacting binding sites, are non-interacting, independent binding sites. And this is the three binding regions or three binding sites that we have identified in our very primitive experiments in which we propose the range of affinity for the dissociation constant in these complexes. So Now we have identified the anchoring residues for copper at the N-terminus. Histidine and methionine at position, the amino terminal group of methionine at position now. One, which is the higher affinity binding site. So this is the bottleneck now. So we had to perform the convolution of copper binding site in the N-terminal region. And for doing that, we use CT spectroscopy. The problem with the free protein is that there is two bands that are developed, that is this band, this positive band, and this negative band, upon adding one equivalent of copper. Beyond one equivalent of copper, we have here two bands that start to be developed, this band and this band. So it should reflect the formation of the second metal complex in the N-terminus region. And this is the case, the profile that we, or the spectra, sorry, that we get in the case of the histidine mutant. So only this one and only this one. So by comparing both spectra, we can assign unequivocally that this one here and this one here correspond to the complex between the methionine one and copper. And that this one here and this one here that are developed once the second equivalent of copper is added correspond to the complex with the histidine. And of course, it should be the binding site with the lower affinity because it's the second binding site that is being populated. To test that, we make a competitive study with glycine. Glycine is able to form this complex with copper with an affinity or dissociation constant of 20 micromolar. So if we have two binding sites in the N-terminus, one with 0.1 micromolar and the other with 35 micromolar, we expect that this the addition of glycine will be able just to release the copper from the lower affinity binding site. I mean, this binding site that has a dissociation constant of 35 micromolar. And it is what happened exactly. This is the spectra of the protein with two equivalents of copper added, and you see that we start to add glycine to the sample, this signal or this band disappear and this band disappear, and this band correspond to the histidine copper complex. So glycine is forming a complex with copper and releasing the copper from the complex with histidine. And since glycine has an affinity in 20 micromolar range, histidine complex cannot be or cannot have an affinity in the 0.1 micromolar range. So this is the lower affinity binding sites in the N-terminus, and this corresponds to the high affinity binding site for copper in the N-terminus. So you see that it's NMR, MALDI-TOF, CD, molecular biology. It's a lot of work because I insist, I want to have fun, and my students want also to have fun. I mean, this is the way to have fun. I mean, there's another way, but I mean. And of course, if we then check that and confirm by using isothermal titration calorimetry, okay, and we are able to measure two binding sites with an affinity in 0.1 micromolar, 35 micromolar, and in the mutant, only one binding site with 0.12 micromolar, confirming that the high affinity binding site for copper involves interaction with methionine position 1. So, we then use EPR, this paramagnetic resonance spectroscopy, in which we are not detecting now the nuclear spin, but information from the electron that is in the electronic environment of copper. And I will not go into detail, but this is a very useful technique to get an idea of the coordination geometry of the complexes. So we conclude from here that the complex between copper and the methionine was involved the interaction of the metal ion with two nitrogen and two oxygens. In the case of histidines, well, with three nitrogen and one oxygen. And in the case of the C-terminus, as expected, involved interaction with at least four oxygen inside them. Well, I mean, this is a region that is very rich in aspartic and glutamic, so it corresponds very well with our findings. So this is the picture that we have now. Oh, sorry. We have the protein. We have identified three binding sites for copper in the protein. We have determined also the structure or the coordination geometry for each of these sites in the molecule. We have also determined the affinity feature of each sites. Then we know we want to go now for the molecular mechanism by which these metal ions accelerate the aggregation of the protein. Because now we have very detailed information. Location of binding sites, affinity features of these binding sites, and current residues. Very detailed information that we will translate into the molecular mechanism behind the induction of the amyloid aggregation of alpha-synuclein. And we study the effect of copper with the different mutants. In this mutant, the three binding sites are there. In this mutant, we have just two binding sites, one at the methionine and the other at C-terminal. In this mutant, we lack the C-terminus binding site, and we have the histidine binding site and the methionine binding site in N-terminus. And in this mutant, we have just one binding site, that is the one involving methionine. So by studying, characterizing, I mean, this we have done not by fluorescent, but by NMR, you can see that in addition of copper, you perform an experiment in the function of time, then you can see that the monomer, the signal corresponding to the monomer species disappear from the spectrum. Because oligomers are formed, oligomer has large molecular weight, so we are not able to detect these oligomers by NMR. So we have also determined the structure of these high affinity binding sites that involves the interaction of copper with the nitrogen atom in the side chain that involves also the other nitrogen is coming from the amide of aspartic at position 2. One oxygen is provided by the carboxylate side chain of aspartic, also at position 2, and the other oxygen is provided by a water molecule. But we have also determined the structure. And we have shown by studying this different behavior from this different mutant that the formation of the high affinity binding site for copper, I mean, that this one that involves the interaction with methionine, is a critical step in the metal mediated alpha synuclein amyloid formation. I mean, this behavior is independent of the presence of the histidine or not. I mean, the histidine is not involved in the mechanism by which copper accelerates the aggregation. So we performed there an experiment that linked the acceleration of the or induced by metal ions. Here you increase the level of divalent metal ions in the millimolar range. Here we are using iron, manganese, and copper. Okay, you see that mainly the binding sites of copper we are not using here. Mainly the KD that we have determined is in the millimolar range. We can see here that the affected residues that are rolling beyond detection are located to the C-terminus region, and that when you increase the millimolar concentration of this metal ion, then the aggregation is kinetic is accelerated. So how to get structural information about that? What you can get, for example, is if you use a diamagnetic metal ion, a thing that is not paramagnetic, this is the profile for the protein in the free state that we have measured by using spermagnetic spin label. What is evidence in the formation of a transient long-range interaction with is the C-terminus, and the NAC region. This green ball is the spin level that is attached to the NAC region at this position. So under this condition, all the signals in the C-terminus are broadened and the intensity are reduced because they are close in the space. Okay? We are within this 25 angstrom limit. What happened in the presence of divalent metal ions, as zinc, that is, would be also the case for manganese or iron. You see that in the presence of this metal ion that binds exclusively to the C-terminal region, there is an increase now in the intensity of these signals in these regions. In this region, the increase is due now because this residue, when they form the complex with the metal ion, are not affected anymore for the presence of this paramagnetic spin layer. And if they are not affected, it means that they are at a larger distance now. So that is what happened. In the presence of the binding of this metal ion to the C-terminus, there is a release of this conformation. This is the free protein, this is the NAC region, this is the C-terminus region. It's folded back. So if this is folded back, so the NAC region, hydrophobic, is not exposed, and so the protein is protected against the aggregation. But when metal ions binds to this region, there is a release of this conformation, then the NAC region becomes exposed to the solvent, and so is able to interact with other monomeric species of the molecule through hydrophobic interaction, driven by this NAC region. And self-association, nucleation takes place, and now that once that this takes place, so the aggregation is accelerated. So this is the mechanism why these metal ions accelerate the aggregation of the protein. But why copper is able to accelerate the aggregation of the protein in the low micromolar range? Of course, higher concentration of copper in the millimolar range would be able to accelerate also. But it means that the mechanism is different. I will skip that. The mechanism is different, and since the interaction of copper with the protein is highly specific, I mean, we propose here that the mechanism of, by which copper induce or accelerate the aggregation of the protein is related to a mechanism that gives rise to metal catalyzed oxidation of the proteins. In this mechanism, the protein is able, must be able to interact with the two redox state of copper, copper 2 or copper 1. And then when the copper complex with the protein is formed and copper is reduced in the presence of the a reductant, we have to say that within the neurons there is a higher, very, very high levels of ascorbate. So I mean, it's a very redundant environment. Then if the copper is reduced to copper 1 and the protein is able to bind to copper 1 and to form a complex, then this gives rise to the generation of what we call reactive oxygen species that will induce an oxidative damage in the protein, and this oxidative damage gives rise or may lead to a cascade of structural alterations that of course will give rise to a pool of alpha-synuclein molecules that are more prone to aggregates. So to demonstrate that this may be the case, we have to demonstrate again that the protein is able to bind copper in the reduced and oxidized state, and the interaction of the protein with both states of copper inducing the protein an oxidative damage. So to do that, we create first the copper 2 complex with alpha-synuclein, and then we add a high amount of ascorbate, that is a reductant that reduce the copper complex, and you can see we identify the binding sites for copper 1 in the protein. It means the protein is able to bind copper 1. And the two methionines, methionine 1 and methionine 5, are the residues involved in binding of the reduced state of copper 1. This was clearly demonstrated by NMR. By doing NMR experiments on different peptides in which one of these methionine residues were mutated, we conclude that for the high affinity binding sites of copper 1 to alpha synuclein, both methionines are necessary. Methionine at position 1 and position 5. And We then determined the residues involved in copper, in the binding of copper 1. So we can conclude that the protein is able to bind copper 1 and copper 2 redox system. So the protein becomes modified. I mean, there is an oxidative damage on the protein because of this interaction. And you can perform very easy experiments. That means this is the experiment, it is a free protein. This signal corresponds to the signal of methyl groups in the methionine. We have four methionines, and we have just four signals here for this methionine that we have already assigned. This is a proton NMR spectrum on the protein. Then, if you may study the interaction with copper 1, and then you expose this to the air to make to oxidize the copper and to induce the oxidative damage on the protein, you can observe here there are two signals that disappear almost, or which whose intensity are affected. And I mean, fantastically, this signal corresponds to the methionine involved in copper 1, which is the reason why these residues are being, the intensity are decreased. And you can see here, this is the spectra, the NMR spectra of these signals from methionine in absence of copper, and this is in the presence of copper. You see that there is a decrease in the intensity of the signals of this methionine that is associated with the formation of other signals that correspond to methionine residues that are oxidized to sulfoxides. I mean, this is the first evidences that upon recycling of copper between both redox state, the protein became oxidized. So, in both methionines. So, we also confirmed that by Malditov, in which this is the spectra of the free protein, and this is a spectra with it forming the copper complex, and after exposure to air, so the protein became oxidized, and we are detecting here two more peaks that correspond to methionine sulfoxides. So the next step that we are working in our laboratory now is try to determine, because the proposal is that because of the oxidation of the protein, there is a cascade of a structural change that lead to a pool of modified molecules, or alpha-synuclein molecules, that are more prone to aggregates. So to do that, we are now trying to purify a large amount of oxidized protein and to see what happened with the network of long-range interaction in the oxidized state of the protein induced by the interaction with copper and compare with alpha-synuclein. This is the work that probably next year I could show you. Let's move now to the inhibitors strategy. Of course, several people is using inhibitor, amyloid inhibitor type to prevent the advance of this or the progress of these diseases. More than initially were focused and tried to disrupt or dissolve this amyloid fiber formation. If you make a search in biography literature, you can find that there is several thousand of these compounds that are being used as amyloid inhibitors. Some of them even are in phase 1 or 2 in clinical trials in Alzheimer's disease. However, if you try to find information about the molecular mechanism or the structural basis why these compounds are effective as amyloid inhibitors, nothing comes. So, and this is critical. It's key because if you want to design more effective amyloid inhibitors, then you have to know in your target molecule which are the target sites in which these compounds bind, and also you have to know which are the physicochemical properties of these compounds that are important to be effective. So we decided to start with a compound of the family of the porphyrins, and the reason why we decided to start is because the stellacyanine in their tetrasulfonate form was shown to be very effective against prion disease. in vivo and in vitro. Also, these molecules were efficient inhibitors of the aggregation of A beta amyloid on the tau protein. And at this time, we were working with meta-analysis. This paper was published in Biochemistry, showing that this compound, this was stelacyanin without no metal, we worked with the apoform in this study. They also here worked with the apoform. PCTS, that is a stelacyanin in a tetrasulfonate form, was able to inhibit the aggregation of the process of the protein and even give rise to less toxic aggregates, and that the effect was mediated by the binding of these compounds to the C-terminal region of the protein. Now, let's analyze a little bit just what's are concluding from this work. What can you observe in the periphery of this compound? Those that are not sleeping, what you can observe? I mean, tetrasulfonates, negatively charged groups. What is the main property of the C-terminus? It's very rich in negatively sick. So, it's very elementary. I mean, I wonder how this theory could be proposed and even published. So we started to study this. First, the first experiment that, we are talking about designing efficient amyloid inhibitors to cure, to try to make or to cure this pathology. I mean, if the starting point is wrong, forget it. So we started to perform our own experiments with alpha-synuclein. This is the aggregation of alpha-synuclein, and this is the aggregation in the presence of PCTS, and indeed it's an effective inhibitor of the amyloid aggregation of the protein. We also use electronic microscopy to see the amount of fibrils, and of course the amount of fibrils was substantially reduced, almost reduced to very, very low amount, and the aggregates were characterized mainly by amorphous aggregate in the presence of these compounds. And so we have checked the biological effect of this compound. We again go to try to explain or to elucidate the structural basis behind this behavior. So we studied the interaction of these compounds with alpha-synuclein. And again, we observe some signals that are broadened beyond detection, the spectra of the protein in the presence of PCTS. But this broadening is not due to any paramagnetic effect, because this is the apoform, they have not any metal ion. This is due, it's related to the affinity. I mean, the affinity is in the intermediate time scale, so the signals become broader. I mean, the affinity is in the low micromolar range. It's an important, not very, very high as expected, but is a micromolar range affinity. So the signals are broadened. And you can see, again, if you relate the intensity of the signals in the presence of these compounds with the intensity of the signal in the recording in the spectra without the adding this compound, then you can get these profiles. And what this profile is showing you is the regions, the well-defined region in which these compounds interact. And Eureka, these are in the N-terminus and not in the C-terminus. So the two main regions of interaction are located in the N-terminus. Only a third region of interaction, weakest interaction, is located in the N-terminus. And when you relate this binding profile with the primary sequence of the protein, these are the regions we're affecting here, that are affecting, that we have identified here. And you can see that all of these regions are centered on aromatic residues. And also that the aromaticity of these compounds is very high. So we started to think about the P stacking interaction between the aromatic aromatic rings, macrocycle of PCTS, and the aromatic side chains in these residues. if you compare with the results coming from other compounds, as Congo-Rec and Lagmoid, they also interact in the NAC region, but you see that in the N-terminus region, but they affect all the region. Even they affect also the NAC region, and they is not comparable with the well-defined specific interaction profile that we get in the presence of PCTS. Also, this is one of the, I would say, four, five, six cases in which a compound is able to bind to the monomeric species of the amyloid chain protein. Most of the compounds, 5 minutes? I will try. 10, 15. Inflation, I mean. I lost now, okay.
Sorry.
Oh, no problem.
Do they bind the monomeric before?
Okay, the monomeric. Most of the compounds, you were not sleeping, by sure. most of the compounds are being tested. They bound to intermediate species, to oligomeric species. Mm-hmm. So, and this information up to now is blind because we cannot get information about which is the residue being affected by the binding because we are not able to make a direct detection of these complexes. So, you can see, then to check if these residues were critical for interaction with this compound, we prepare the different mutants of these residues. Mm? And you can see that in this case, when we prepare this mutant with tyrosine of position 39, we lack this component. Mm? We lack this binding component. It means this residue is critical, is key for the interaction. The binding component in this mutant is, there is still a residual binding component. And in the double mutant, we have exactly the same behavior, residual binding component. It means that the main and current residue for PCTS binding to alpha-synuclein is tyrosine at position 39. And this is confirmed when you, for example, increase the concentration of sodium chloride, this binding component disappears, but this binding component is not affected. It means there is here, the character of the interaction is mainly aromatic. Here there are another factor beside the aromatic interaction that probably comes from electrostatic, because there is a lot of lysines around this region. So we are detecting this interaction through the backbone, through the backbone amines. But we are concluding that this is monitoring the interaction with the side chain. So we make experiment to detect directly the interaction of this compound with the side chains. But you see that what happened by using 1D NMR, that the tyrosine 39 is mainly broadened by the interaction with this compound, and that this disappears in the 2D spectrum, which we are using here carbon 13 proton HSQC. We are detecting the side chains directly, the place in which the binding even takes place. So again, confirming that the tyrosine in position 39 is a more important coding site for PCTS binding to alpha-synuclein. So if this is the high affinity, this is the main uncoding residue for this compound. So we should assume that the effect of this compound is mediated by this interaction. And indeed, if you prepare make these mutants, you can see that when, of course, they are not conservative mutants because we are replacing a tyrosine by an alanine, but you see that when we replace phenylalanine at position 4, the amyloid chain of the protein is not changed. But when we replace tyrosine at position 39, the protein is not able to aggregate anymore. It means that this residue is critical for the aggregation of the protein. And this is the residue that is being targeted by this compound. Then we now a target molecule, but we also now a target site. And this is very important. And the reason why probably is, you know, this is the fibrinogenic core that you can determine by using solid state of amyloid fibrils. And tyrosine 30 now, I mean, this fibrinogenic core stands for ratio 36 to 98. So, and tyrosine at position 39 is strategically located at the beginning of this interaction. So probably should be a very important residue for stabilize this interaction and directing the formation of the amyloidogenic core of the protein. So now let's go to the physicochemical properties of the compounds that are important to agree, because if we want to design more effective compounds, we have to know information also about the compounds. So if you simply change or you simply bound a metal ion to the central cavity of these compounds, you change the biological activity of this compound. It is well published in different areas. So we tested what happened here. And you see, when aluminum is bound, the molecule is not efficient as inhibitor, but when zinc or nickel is there, it's very efficient. If you study the NMR profile, you see that nickel derivative or zinc derivative are able to interact with the protein, whereas the aluminum derivative is not able to interact with the protein. That's the reason why it's not effective. And the binding sites are similar to that identified previously to the upper form of PCTS. And then you study the aggregation state of the compounds. I mean, these compounds are able to form stacking interactions. So they are usually in the lower order stacked aggregates in solution. You see that in the case of PCTS or nickel or zinc, these broad signals, what are identify is that the formation of low order stacked aggregate of PCTS. In the cases of aluminium, there are not such a formation. So these are the species that are able to interact with alpha-synuclein. Low order stacked aggregate, low order means because we are detecting by NMR. Otherwise, we wouldn't be able to detect by NMR. Let's go now to the mechanism, which is the mechanism by which these compounds inhibit the amyloid aggregation of the protein. It could involve a mechanism that should redirect this alpha-synuclein species to on pathway species, or maybe a mechanism that involves the trapping of off-pathway oligomers. So there are two mechanisms or two studies to differentiate that. One is the seeding experiments. I mean, these aggregates, these oligomers are able to seed and to accelerate the amyloid fiber formation or the kinetic of the protein, but these aggregates are not able. So you can see here that this is the protein, the kinetic of aggregation of alpha-synuclein, this is the kinetic of aggregation of alpha-synuclein, in the presence of other aggregates that are seeding, and this is an acceleration, the lag phase is almost lagged, and in the presence of alpha-synuclein PCTS aggregate, there is also an acceleration. So it means this should be the mechanism. This should be the pathway that is affected by PCTS and not this. And indeed, what we are detecting here by using CDS, SDS pages, is that already at 8 hours of the aggregation, there is an accumulation of species. I mean, what is doing this compound is to is correlated with the trapping of prefibrillar species, interfering with the progress of this species toward the formation of amyloid fibrils. So, I will skip this. This is the mechanism that we propose for synuclein, so for this PCT. So this compound interacts with the monomers. The monomers start to form a nucleus, but the nucleation phase is affected. So the nucleation under in the presence of this compound is not able to progress to the formation of amyloid fiber, and that is the reason why we are detecting this accumulation of these prefibrillary tissues in our SDS patient experiments. Give me time, just two or three slides. We then prepare different mutants in which we mutated the tyrosine position 39. Because, you know, please, no, don't, this is not published results. So.
Questions?
Nice talk.
Thank
professor.
You very much.
You showed us many studs with metal lions with alpha synuclein, but are there other studs with other proteins that form amyloid fibrils?
With metal ions?
Yeah.
Yes. A beta peptide, copper in the case of A beta peptide. We have to keep in mind that aggregation of A beta peptide is an extracellular phenomenon if you compare with alpha synuclein. And the amount of the levels of copper in the extracellular medium is around 10 to 15 micromolar. The affinity of copper by A beta peptide is in the same order as alpha synuclein, 0.1 micromolar. So these levels of copper are very effective to induce aggregation of the protein. This is very well studied, very well characterized in vitro and in vivo, that the misregulation of metal ions and mainly copper in the case of A beta peptide is related to the acceleration of the amyloidogenicity and the onset of Alzheimer's disease. Indeed, there is a clinical trial. They are using metal chelators, copper chelators, as compounds to prevent the acceleration of the progress of the disease. In the case of prion disease, I mean, indeed, it was proposed that the prion protein is a copper chaperone, okay, and that the binding of copper is the event that triggered the change between the non-infected and an infected entity in this protein.
Hello. Do you know if some of these metal porphyrins have superoxide dismutase activity?
I don't know. Sorry.
Hello. Considering your mass spectrometric studies with the alpha synuclein, I don't know for sure, but you show MS spectra with
MALDI MS spectra.
MALDI.
We can show. Yeah.
Please, can you get sure. The line? It's just curiosity. Yes. When you were talking about the copper-induced.
Your mates are very glad because you're.
When you're talking about the copper-induced oxidation of this synuclein. I think
it's
a complete protein, or it's just a fragment of the protein? Because
No. This is a complete. I mean, this is, okay.
Yes, that one.
This is.
No.
So many slides, I can't believe that. My God, sorry for that. This is the full length protein. This is the full length protein, the peaks that correspond to the molecular weight of the full length protein. This is the protein pre-incubated with this diethyl pyrocarbonate that is able to modify six sites there. And this is the protein pre-incubated with copper after incubated with the diethyl pyrocarbonate, and this is the spectrum. This is a full-length protein. In this case, this spectra correspond to different fragments of the protein that was subjected to a tryptic digestion before.
With are oxidated. Have you done MS-MS spectra?
Yes, this is a MS-MS spectra, which is collision. This is a collision-induced dissociation experiment that we did to determine that the methionine was an anchoring residue. I didn't want to go into the detail because I didn't know that. This is a collision-induced dissociation MS-MS spectra of this fragment. That is fragment 1 to 6 that we obtain after tryptic digestion, and is one of the fragments, is the other fragment that was identified as a copper binding fragment.
It's just so general because I'm doing something not quite like that, but I'm trying to do some MS spectra with oxidated proteins, and I found very interesting your experiments because I have a familiar spectra in my experiments, but not for deoxidative, but the nitrous activations. So uh-huh. It's just a matter of...
We can talk later, no problem.
Okay.
Any more questions? Yeah. Daniel, what...
Hi. Does the PCTs affect in the same way the aggregation of A30P or other mutants without affecting...
If the compounds inhibit, is able to inhibit also other amyloidogenic species, you
yes.
mean? As A beta or prion?
No.
The mutants.
A30P.
What I mean, it was not able to inhibit the aggregation of I-39 eosine or I-39 leucine mutants.
It's that position PCT binds, okay?
Binds if tyrosine is there. So the aromaticity, the point is that before doing this mutation work, we proposed that the tyrosine at position 39 was key for the aggregation or for the amyloidogenicity of the protein. It was also the key residue that was targeted by this compound to exert its inhibitory effect.
Yeah.
You mean A30P? A30P. We didn't do any interaction with. Sorry, I got so many mutants that I. Okay. Yes. We didn't try with this.
But it will be a good question.
Yeah. Sure.
Definitely.
Thank you, Sherson, for the translation.
This is just, I guess, more of a comment. So on the prion protein with regard to the metal binding, there's two different metal binding sites with very different
for copper.
Moieties. And one is actually in the aggregation prone region, and it seems that if the copper is present there, as argued first by our group and then later by
You mean histidine at position 111 and histidine at position 96?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, the 96 one actually.
Yeah.
So if you, that's much weaker at the 111.
Exactly.
But so as argued first by us and later by Jerry Bernholtz's group at North Carolina State, that if you bind the copper there, it actually can inhibit the conversion to the prion form. And in fact, if you look at the tissues, you actually find postmortem at least that the tissues are copper deficient.
Okay.
And manganese rich for whatever reason. So anyway, that's just a comment.
It's been nice. Been nice to know.
Okay, well, if you didn't further question, let's thank again.
Thank you very much.